fine. I would first of all cordially thank those who made it possible for me to come here. The reason why I'm here is that about two weeks ago, I bumped into Itzhak and Alain when strolling over Rue des Écoles. And we sort of engaged in a small talk, and I don't know why, but I said, you know, what interests me most, but I don't work on it, is how so very different behavioral dispositions can coexist in such a highly interconnected system as the brain and be switched between them very rapidly. And then they said, well, we are running a conference on this in 2 weeks from here. So I canceled a number of commitments to make it possible to be here. And I'm very grateful for this day. It was fascinating so far. What I will try to do is give you some insights, because we are a very heterogeneous population, into how we think the brain is organized, into its dynamics, and perhaps provide some hypothesis, at least, of how this switching between states that coexist could occur on the fly. So I would like to start with an epistemic caveat. Because it's obvious that what we can perceive, imagine, and comprehend is constrained by the cognitive system that we use in order to acquire knowledge about the world and about ourselves. And this organ is the product of an evolutionary process, as is true for every other organ. And this brain has adapted to a mesoscopic scale of the reality of the environment in which life has evolved, which is a very, very small segment of the dimension of reality. So this means that our cognition is certainly optimized to secure survival in a highly complex, insecure, and unpredictable world that has very specific manifestations and is by no way generalizable to overall dimensions. And this certainly requires other strategies than a philosophical strategy of acquiring absolute truth about the things behind the phenomena. So means our cognitive abilities must be constrained, they must be idiosyncratic, and probably this is also the way in which we reason. This is a caveat for the rest of what I'm going to say. What do neurobiologists believe nowadays? We believe that all the knowledge that we have resides in the functional architecture of the nervous system, the way in which neurons are connected to each other. That also the rules and the programs that underlie our cognitive and executive functions, they also reside in this architecture. Then we say that all mental functions, including the highest cognitive functions that are very often associated with mind and immaterial dimensions, they are the consequence of neuronal processes and never the cause of a neuronal process. And then we say that the neuronal processes in our brains obey the known laws of nature. Now, the evidence for these rather bold statements is that we are able to explain the behavior of simple organisms from the knowledge of the state of their central nervous systems. And these, we know, follow the laws of nature. Then we know that evolution is conservative. It preserved what has been proven adaptive and carries it through the whole evolutionary tree. There are no new mechanisms. There's only increased complexity and, of course, epigenetic shaping of architectures through cultural influences. Now, we have an explanatory gap that is quite nagging. We know a lot about microcircuits in neurons, and we also know from non-invasive imaging studies and neuropsychological studies, clinical studies, we have a fairly good knowledge about how higher cognitive functions or executive functions emerge from large networks. At least we know which networks are responsible for which functions, by and large. But we completely ignore, this is at least my conviction, how these functions emerge from the detailed interactions of the many distributed microprocessors in the brain. So we know a lot about neurons. We have difficulties to understand what emerges from the interaction of neurons among each other. This is a simulated interaction of a few hundred neurons. This is a small number, but you see the extreme complexity of the graph interactions that are possible in such a network. And this is quite a realistic reproduction of what happens in the neuronal network in the brain. So there are major changes in our views on the brain that have happened over the last decade. Initially, we based our hypothesis on the assumption that we have to do with a very hierarchically organized, stimulus-driven linear system, essentially an input-output machine. And now it appears that we deal with a very complex self-organizing system that has non-linear dynamics and has a very soft hierarchy. It gets away without a CEO on top of it. In a sense, this is a migration from strict behaviorism to constructivism. We attribute the initiative to the brain rather than to the environment nowadays. So, question is, what is the neuronal substrate of the perceiving, deciding, value assigning, intentional self? Related to the question that Peter had addressed just a moment ago. Is there a supraordinate center in the brain, as our introspection certainly does suggest? And here is a puzzle. Our intuition about how the brain works is radically different from what the scientific evidence obtained from a third-person perspective provides to us. The brain is transparent to us. We have no feeling for what's going on in the brain. And as you will see in a minute, the processes in the brain are so imaginably complex that our simple approach and intuition is not able to grasp it. And even nowadays, mathematics are not able to find descriptions for these processes. So, briefly summarize, intuition suggests there must be a supraordinate instance in the brain. That's the place where decisions are taken, values assigned, plans made for future acts. And we equate this instance with the intentional, the conscious self. And this has been done all along the Occidental philosophical traditions, of course. Descartes thought it was the pineal organ. Also, the machines that we construct are built according to this principle. We have an input, function the sensory surface, and then we have a hierarchical sequence of processing steps that are mainly supporting serial processing from input to higher centers, then there's convergence to some executive organ. This is how most of our artificial intelligence systems are built, and they are quite performing, but this is not at all how the brain is organized. What we learn from looking at the anatomy of the brain, at the connectivity, we see an unexpectedly dense interconnection at all scales. It's surprising, it's more than 60% of all possible connections among the nodes, i.e. neurons or areas, are actually realized in the brain. This is a mind-boggling, densely interconnected system. We see, very different from what we had thought should be the case, a prevalence of reciprocal connections. Most neurons are reciprocally talking to each other. We see massive top-down projections. 10 times more comes from inside to out than from outside to in. It puts the hierarchy on top, reverses it. This is too special. So we focus, or we see a soft hierarchy in the system. You have seen these pictures already. Many areas in the cerebral cortex, making up the cerebral cortex, dealing with very different aspects of cognition and executive functions. The puzzle is the interconnectivity of these elements in there. This is a snapshot of some fairly realistic reconstruction of a little piece of cerebral cortex with the connections between neurons and their dendrites. This is a result of a meta-study showing the connectivity matrix of a subset of cortical areas in a monkey brain. Visual areas here, every red dot stands for an area in which myriads of cells are contained, and some executive areas in the prefrontal cortex engaging in the control of attention. Now, the same situation, and these white lines, they stand for massive reciprocal neuronal connections, millions and millions of fibers. So if one knows one's way in this system, it's possible to get from any neuron here to any other neuron with only one or two switching stations. So it's a fantastic metro plan organized here. Very much the same motif is repeated in the human brain, as we can see from non-invasive imaging studies. This is just a nice picture to show you the fiber paths that are intertwined in the system in order to interconnect the neurons. A brief Gedanken experiment to give you an impression of what the neuronal representation of a percept or an intention or a decision might possibly be. This is the sensory system of a cat. The black dots stand for particular cortical areas, for visual ones, tactiles, auditory, and the limbic areas, which associate emotional connotations to perceptual contents. And these colored graphs are again standing for massive, mainly reciprocal neuronal connections, thousands and thousands of fibers. Imagine that such a system is confronted with a barking dog that can be touched, seen, and heard. In this case, thousands, millions of neurons will be active in the different visual areas, analyzing the various visual aspects of this animal, how big it is, where it is, the color, texture of its fur, etc. The auditory system will decode, again in a very distributed way, the barking, the tactile system, if one touches the fur, the consistency, etc. And the limbic system, finally, will add its comment with respect to whether it's an aggressive dog or a peaceful dog. And now is the interesting question, where is the representation of this dog in this system? And you wouldn't be able to pinpoint to any of these sites. It is a very complex, high-dimensional, spatiotemporal cloud of activity. And this is the not further reducible description of this percept. And it is very likely that all the other cognitive contents, not only perceptual contents, but also a motor program, a motor plan, a decision, is coded in very much the same way, distributed. Such distributed systems, of course, have huge management problems, because there could be more than just one object out in the world, a dog and a cat and a mouse, in which case there would be three interdigitating, interleaved clouds of activity that need to be kept separate so that the brain knows at any one moment in time which activity pattern is actually corresponding to which percept. So many different things can coexist there, but they can be somehow be kept separate. Now, for the sake of time, I won't go into mechanistic details of how this could be achieved. There is some evidence that nature uses the temporal domain in order to express semantic relatedness. It uses simultaneity of events, so binding in time, in order to express that distributed activity patterns are related with each other by simply modulating the activity of neurons in time domain, making them oscillate, print a temporal structure on them, which then allows, after this passing of time, to associate in particular time windows what needs to be bound together. It's an important process for learning, of course. So, as I said, nature probably uses temporal coherence of the dynamics in this system in order to express semantic relations between these very many different computational results. So, in summary, the brain now appears as a decentralized, self-organizing system rather than a hierarchically structured stimulus-driven response machine. There is no supraordinate center in the brain that would orchestrate all this very complex dynamics. It's a self-organizing phenomenon. Then particular functions are realized in widely distributed networks that are dynamically configured by temporal coordination. And one of these temporal coordination strategies is to synchronize activity in a very dynamic and flexible way on the backbone of the connectome. So, results of cognitive processes are with all likelihood encoded in these distributed assemblies of temporarily bound neurons. These assemblies are metastable. They come and they go at a very rapid pace, changing in configuration on the backbone of the fixed anatomical connections. And this is probably, or most likely, not only the case for percepts, but also for plans and decisions. Already said this. So why is all this interesting in our context? Because of this architecture, the brain is bound to be a highly nonlinear, high-dimensional dynamic system. Why? Because of the ubiquity of recurrent connections. And recurrency is one constitutive feature of highly nonlinear, high-dimensional dynamic systems. In particular, if the individual nodes of such networks are configured as oscillators, which is the case in the brain. So what we face all over, especially in the cerebral cortex, is that the nodes, neurons, or areas, or columns, they are configured, these are the colored things here, colored dots, they have a propensity to oscillate, and they are reciprocally coupled in a very, very complex way. Part of this is genetically determined, part of this coupling is restructured by learning, by epigenetic shaping. So, now the constitutive feature of nonlinear dynamical systems, as these systems are, there's no way around it, and there's good evidence nowadays that the dimensionality of the dynamics of these systems is unimaginably high. We have no intuition for it. We cannot imagine how high dimensional this system is. But the interesting phenomenon of nonlinear dynamical systems is that they are capable of undergoing phase transitions. And here you see a very classical demonstration of what the nonlinear dynamical system is. You have these, I expired the battery here. You see those two shapes that are intertwined. And when in such a system, and this is a, this graph represents two possible states of a relatively simple low-dimensional nonlinear dynamic system. So it's far, far more simple than what you could imagine that the brain would be. But it shows a characteristic. In one state, the system tends to stay in the left lobe. So the trajectories are these ovoids, when it will circle around those hollows, those holes, for a very long time. But sometimes it switches its state. We say it makes a phase transition, and it switches over in the other attractor, and then stays there for as long as, one cannot really predict how long it will stay there. Because at these crossing points where these two attractors meet, excitability is high. This might be related to this high state of excitability that Itzhak was mentioning in the case of the syndrome E. It's very easy, tiny little disruptions, tiny little noise effects may cause the system from leaving the attractor on the left side and entering the attractor on the right side, to go from one defined state in a completely different defined state, and you have to see this as a high-dimensional state space. So the system can reside in one state, which may have a behavioral connotation, and stay there for a long time, and then all of a sudden move over to the other one, and then be as comfortable and as stable as it was previously. So it goes from one metastable state into the other metastable state. Very much as when with severe depression, one observes frequently that people go to bed and wake up with deep sadness and deeply depressed, as if the system had just switched from one state into the other and then got stuck there, and then with an electroconvulsive shock, it's like pressing a reset button, you shake it back into this other attractor, and then it's for a while normal again. You have this imperception all the time. You flip between equally likely percepts, but you can bias the attractor space. In this case, on the left side you will see black dragons, but on the right side you will see the reverse, the white dragons. And somewhere in between, the system has difficulties to decide. It should just give you an intuitive feeling of how it is to switch between those states. In this case, a very primitive situation. So in conclusion, nonlinear dynamic system can be multistable and rapidly transit between very different stable states. There is no need to have a separation of different behavioral dispositions in spatially segregated centers. It can all be packed into one depending on the dynamic state in which it is. It will behave this way or the other way. Then switches between states can be triggered by minor shifts of set points. doesn't really take much in order to shift the dynamic system into such a bifurcation. At the moment of making a decision, so when it flips from one attractor state to the next or makes another just a normal decision, only this very decision was possible. There was no alternative, so much to the question of free will. But because it's a nonlinear dynamical system, it's entirely unpredictable how it will decide in the future. You cannot predict such a system, but retrospectively, you have to say it couldn't have behaved otherwise in that very moment. And now, I added this morning when listening to the talks. Of course, the same nonlinear dynamics dominates the interaction within groups. So, agents that cooperate in groups, they are all reciprocally coupled. And it is to be expected that the group dynamic shows exactly the same characteristics, that it can flip from one state into the other in a very short transition time through self-organizing, self-promoting processes. So make out of it what you want. Don't know whether it was at all related to what we are discussing here, but I thought it was interesting to consider the brain as a dynamical system. Thank you.